Hey there, Fiber Junkies! Welcome back to The Color Cauldron. I'm Johanna, the owner and dyer behind Push and Yarns and host of this podcast. If you are a new viewer, don't forget to click the link in the description box below so that you can check out my online shop, www.potionyarns.com, and you can see all of my hand-dyed yarns and spinning fiber that I currently have for sale, as well as learn a little bit more about me and my business. Thank you guys for joining me again for week 3 of our wool series. If you have not been here the last couple of weeks, we started a wool series where we are talking about different breeds and types of sheep and wool and how they are good for our knitting and crochet projects and what kind of things we need to know just to differentiate between the breeds, what makes them unique and special, and what kind of blends they work well as what kind of projects they're good for. So we started with just a general wool category a couple weeks ago, and then last week we talked about merino. And this week we have a third installment, so I'm glad you joined me again. Before we jump into our discussion today on Blue Faced Leicester, which is going to be our week 3 series, you probably noticed that I'm wearing something kind of weird today. I had a little mishap this week, and I am fine but slowly recovering from a fall that I took. So I was home the other day just getting ready to dye yarn and doing some stuff around the house and walked down the stairs. We have all hardwood floors in our house, and I was wearing hand-knit socks, and usually I don't have any trouble slipping on the floor, but for whatever reason, I just took a tumble and my foot slipped out from underneath me, and I fell down our stairs pretty hard. And so it was a little bit of a shock, and I laid on the ground for several minutes trying to figure out if anything was broken. Finally decided nothing is actually broken, but definitely in a lot of pain, and I'm not sure if I put a little tiny fracture in my arm or if it's just really banged up and bruised, but it's quite painful. And I found that when I'm not wearing the sling, it's a little bit easier for me to put strain on it and bump it and things. So we thought it would just be safe to have the sling on for a couple of days while I'm recovering. So yeah, that's been an adventure. And unfortunately, I had to get yarn clubs out for our monthly installment, and I was kind of on a time schedule and needed to get them done this weekend. So I didn't do them yesterday when I first fell, but they had to happen today. And so thankfully my hubby was here and was able to assist me in dyeing and do a lot of the heavy lifting and just help with some of the things to make it a little bit easier. But it was slow going, and thankfully I didn't have to do anything else. I was planning to do other dyeing, but I didn't have to do any other dyeing. So we just stuck with what I needed to get done to meet my deadlines this week, and we'll just kind of slowly ease our way back into it. But yeah, I think I need to come up with a cooler story though than just I'm clumsy and fell down the stairs, because that's not very exciting. And I feel like being a swing dancer and doing death-defying air steps all the time, I should probably invent a cooler story for why my arm is in a sling. So I don't want to tell people that I just fell. So anyways, we're going to jump right into our lovely wool series this week. And as I mentioned, we are talking about Blue Faced Leicester, or BFL, today. I know some of you guys are really excited about this installment, and I am as well. So Blue Faced Leicester is actually jumping away from the fine wool category that we talked about last week with merino. So if you remember, we talked about merino being a fine wool, which means that it has a really thin, fine fiber diameter. So the individual fibers are very silky and soft and thin. It also tends to have a shorter staple length for the locks, which can make it easier to pill and makes it a little bit more of a delicate yarn, but it makes it excruciatingly soft. And merino in particular is a good combination of being very soft but also pretty strong for how fine the fibers are. But this week we're going to talk about BFL, which is a long wool. And a long wool is basically any category of wool that comes from a British sheep variation that was started back in the I think it was back in the 1800s or early 1900s, but the long wools are known for having longer staple lengths and really kind of silky, loose, wavy ringlets. So they have ringlets, but they're a little bit more of an undulating waviness to them, not like a high, tight crimp like merino has. And the sheep tend to grow their locks in big, silky ringlets, and when they shear it, it comes off in these big, long coils that make for a really sturdy fiber, because when the staple length is longer like that, it means that the little ends aren't going to poke out as much as some of the fine wools like merino and cause pilling and things like that. So it's very, very sturdy. This is kind of like a medium density yarn, as far as it's not coarse yarn, but it's not as soft as some of the fine wools and some of the other luxury breeds. It's a little bit coarser than that, but it's still quite soft. Definitely good enough for next to the skin wear. And there's several different types of sheep breeds that are considered a long wool, and they tend to range from 24 to 41 microns. If you don't remember what a micron is, you can check back 2 weeks ago in the intro to this series that's all about wool in general. We'll tell you what a micron is and why it's important for us to know as we're discussing sheep breeds and what it does to affect your knitting. But just for now, know that it's basically a measurement of how thick it is. So we are going to talk about Blue Faced Leicester today, which is a long wool, but it specifically, or a little history, it specifically comes from a Leicester long wool sheep, which was developed by a guy named Robert Bakewell. And his name might crop up again in our wool series as we get into other breeds. He was actually very instrumental in a lot of different breed varieties, and his Leicester long wools and some of his other sheeps were his other sheep were kind of like the grandfathers of several other breeds that then were developed from those sheep. So that's where we get BFL from. They came from the Leicester long wools that he developed and were just a further genetic mutation that they bred specifically to get specific characteristics. If you're new to the podcast, by the way, this is Phoebe. She's one of my three kitties, and she frequently joins us on the podcast like she's doing today. She's very sweet, but she is a total ham, and she loves to be in front of the camera, so she's frequently found on the podcast. Alrighty, so we talked about Robert Bakewell developed these sheep. They did originate in England, like most, if not all, of the long wools, and the BFL specifically was developed in the early 1900s, and then it wasn't imported into Canada until the 1970s. And then shortly after that, it got into the US. So it's a relative newcomer on the wool scene here in the United States and Canada, but still it's been around for several decades now. It really has started gaining popularity, I feel like, in the last 10 or 15 years or so, as far as more and more knitters are starting to hear about it, understand what it is, specifically seek it out for their projects. Before that, even though it was here in the US, it wasn't something that most knitters would even know to go and ask for in their local yarn shop. Most yarn shops didn't even really know to look for that specific breed of wool, and a lot of yarn labels just didn't say that. They would just say wool instead of merino and BFL and Polworth and all the other types of wool. So it's really cool that the knitting and fiber industry is really going through what I feel like is kind of a period of deeper education to really help yarn shop owners, dyers, designers, and just hobby knitters and everyday people that like to knit and spin and crochet and everything else, help us to understand the differences in the breeds and what they're good for, and just educate us so we know more of what to ask for and what to look for. So that's pretty cool, I think. So that's where I came from. I did do my homework this week, so I've got my handy little notebook here. So I did want to talk about Blue Faced Leicester get their name from their appearance. But unlike you would think, and unlike it sounds, they don't actually have blue faces. The sheep actually have a black skin, and on their face, they have really tiny, short, white fibers. So little tiny white hairs all over their face, but they're so short that you can see the skin underneath through the hairs. And so when you look at them in certain light, especially from a bit of a distance, the black layered with white over it takes on a blue cast, and hence Blue Faced Leicester. Okay, so also, by the way, if I am mispronouncing Leicester, my British friends can feel free to leave me a comment and let me know the correct pronunciation. I am pretty sure that I've got it right. That's what I've heard and what I've seen, and from my research, that's how it seems to be pronounced, but I might be incorrect because I have not really been around a lot of people that were originally from England when they were saying this word. Most of the English people I've been around, it didn't come up in conversation, so I'm not sure that I'm right, but I'm pretty sure. But if I'm wrong, feel free to leave me a comment and let me know. However, for my US watchers and anybody else that isn't familiar with the way the British people pronounce some of their names in England, it doesn't look like Leicester. It's spelled really, really differently, and you know, you're going to hear all kinds of interesting mispronunciations with that one, I think. Okay, so the specific characteristics of the fiber, we already talked about their longer staple length. So the locks themselves are about 3 to 6 inches long on a BFL sheep. And so like we mentioned, that has a really good way to keep the little ends tucked in more than like a merino or something where they're gonna stick out more often. So BFL tends to be really resistant to pilling, which is awesome. It makes it sturdy, long wearing. You don't have to worry about abrasion as much in things like sweaters, socks, etc. The crimp of the fiber is really open. So crimp is how wavy or curly the locks actually are. And so like when we talked about merino, we talked about how high and tight the crimp was, really close together, really, really high crimp. It's a very fluffy fiber with a lot of movement going on in a short distance. The BFL fiber is longer lock with a more undulating, open kind of a wave to it, more of a wave than a crimp or a curl. So it still gives it that great softness and movement, but it's a little bit more open and loose, which helps it to be really, really sturdy and also really warm. It kind of helps trap air pockets and make it really warm. It does have a fine fiber diameter, especially for a long wool. On the long wool spectrum, it's more on the medium density end than the coarse end. So it BFL, I've heard people refer to it as rivaling merino for softness. I personally don't agree with that. I think it is easy to tell the difference between merino and BFL, in my opinion. But that doesn't by any means mean that it is coarse or scratchy or anything like that. I find BFL absolutely lovely to wear next to the skin, absolutely lovely to dye and work with, but it does have a different feel to me than merino, for sure. So it is quite soft, even though it's not as soft as the fine wools. And then the thing that makes BFL really, really cool, in addition to those things, but the thing that I think makes it stand out more than merino is its drape. Like silk, it has an incredible fluid drape to it, so it just makes absolutely luscious shawls, lovely cowls, scarves, drapey little sweaters, things that you want to have that like drape and that fluidity and movement. BFL is really great for that. Now, it's not going to be as drapey and lustrous as silk, but it is going to have quite a good draping quality, and it also takes dye beautifully. It really loves soaking up those dyes, whether you're using natural dyes, acid dyes. It just really responds well to color, and it shows the color really, really nicely and really shines, which is why I love to work with it as a hand dyer. I just love how it like sucks up that color and gets really saturated and beautiful. Okay, so the micron count of BFL is 24 to 28. And if you remember that the long wool category is 24 to 41, so this is definitely on the finest end of the spectrum for long wools. It is a little bit thicker than merino, not quite as fine as merino, which tends to be in that 16 to 21 range, but it is still going to be quite soft, still delicate enough that you could use it for baby clothes and things like that. It only has moderate felting qualities, which means that you can felt with it as long as it has not been superwash treated. But it's not gonna felt quite as easily. It might take a bit more work than some of the other wools that just are super great at causing that, when you add that friction, causing that felting quality that makes it mat up and create the really cool felt that's real thick, and you can make all kinds of fun things from it. It's great for like slippers and purses and stuff. Okay, so then the other thing I had on here was what I like to blend it with or work with it in blends. Like merino, BFL is really great when you blend it with just about anything. My favorite thing to blend it with probably is nylon, because I love it for socks. So blending with just a little like 20%, 25% of nylon is fantastic for really thick, sturdy, or not necessarily thick, but very sturdy, abrasion resistant socks that are still comfy and cozy. They're really good, just everyday average socks, go anywhere. They can be nice and lacy little patterns that are a little bit more luxurious, or they can be thick, sturdy hiking socks that you shove in some boots to go hiking in the woods. It's really great for just about anything. And you will find the Blue Faced Leicester wool that's in my shop currently is my Dragonfly BFL base, and it is 75% superwash BFL and 25% nylon. And I really love how the nylon helps to add even more strength to the already pretty sturdy BFL, but it kind of gives it that extra washability and extra strength and wear. It's just really good for that, and stretchiness. I also really love BFL with silk, because remember how we mentioned that BFL has great drape? Silk has even better drape, even more luster to it, and they both accept dyes beautifully, and the silk kind of adds that luxurious, kind of extra slinky feel to the BFL, so you get this incredibly luxurious, super drapey, fabulous kind of a fiber that's really awesome for more luxury items. Great, it's great for accessories. You probably could do a sweater in it, but unless it had a little something else in with it like merino or bamboo, I don't know that I'd want it for a full sweater by itself. I'd worry that it would be a bit too drapey, but it's amazing for shawls, for cowls, for scarves, for little boleros that top off another outfit. It's really fantastic for those kinds of things, drapey, slouchy berets, things like that. So yeah, silk is an amazing blend. You just have to watch how much silk is in it and how much BFL and if anything else is blended in to kind of give it a bit more stability, because just BFL and silk, while absolutely lovely, is so drapey, it's really only good for certain projects. BFL is really great with something like another wool, like merino, that just adds even more softness to it. It's also really good with things like cotton, because the cotton adds that extra sturdiness, washability, but it doesn't have any of the elasticity that wool has. So BFL with cotton is a really nice blend, and the BFL can help add that extra elasticity and bounce back factor to the cotton. So like merino, I can't think of a thing that would be a bad blend with BFL, at least not off the top of my head. I did some thinking when I was making my notes, and I was like, yeah, I can't think of anything off the top of my head that would be bad with it. I love alpaca and BFL together, so lovely. I've never seen a cashmere and BFL blend, but I'm sure it would be lovely. So just look around, ask your local yarn store if they have any unique or unusual Blue Faced Leicester blends. Maybe try Googling BFL blends or BFL yarn blends or something, see what you can come up with. As it's getting more popular, there's been more and more attempts to get even more blends and even more variety with the BFL yarns. One thing that I love to do, even if you're struggling to find different blends, you can try using different spinning structures. So try a single ply. If you're a spinner yourself, maybe make a single ply out of your BFL and see how it does. Try doing a two ply, try a four ply, try different kinds of plies in your yarn and different spinning structures. Try smooth, try kind of pebbly, try a little bit boucle, see different things and see how you like to work with it and what kind of things you like to see your BFL in. So I hope that helps you out. I did have a couple of things. I've mentioned a few of these already, but my favorite projects for BFL yarns, if you're a total newbie, have never done it, or even if you've done some BFL knitting and you're just looking for other ideas, my very favorite things to make with it are socks and sweaters, like cardigans, pullovers, etc. I just love socks and sweaters are some of my favorite things anyways, but especially with the BFL, I think they make fantastic, really long-lasting socks. I think they make amazing sweaters. I actually don't have a sweater all out of BFL yet. I have only knit accessories with it, but I think it would be fantastic for one, and I think I'm gonna have to add that on my to-knit list for the fall, because I think it would just make a really great pullover or a cozy cardigan. I really, really love it for shawls, like I mentioned. It's super drapey, super fluid, but it's sturdy and strong too, so it's not gonna pill very easily or be so delicate that you're afraid to ever wear it out of the house. So those are probably my top three things, but really, I don't think you can go wrong with BFL, just like merino. It's so great. You can use it for baby clothes, especially when it's super washed so that it's not gonna have the felting problem and it's easier to wash and care for. But a superwash BFL would be great for baby clothes. You could do blankets. You could probably even do washcloths and things, although I'd look for some that had a cotton blend maybe for that kind of a thing. Just about anything you can come up with, bags, hats, whatever. It's great for all of it, but definitely put socks, sweaters, and shawls on your to-knit list with BFL next time you want to try some. You can find some superwash Blue Faced Leicester yarn in my shop, like I mentioned. The Dragonfly base is currently in the shop. I have been having so much fun dyeing that yarn that I've started to introduce a little bit more of it to the shop. I just ordered a ton of it on my inventory order, so I got bags and bags of it to play around with, and I am gonna have even more coming to the shop this fall. although I'm a little bit slow at production right now due to my fall. I'm not kidding you guys, it hurts so bad. I cried, like straight up bawled when I hit the ground. It was so hard and I was so embarrassed. It was really funny because my husband was at work and I was just here with me and the cats in the house, not another soul in the house, and I'm laying on the floor crying really hard and I kept feeling embarrassed and being like, oh my God, I'm such a baby, and like trying to hold in the tears. And finally I was like, why am I trying not to cry? Like, it genuinely hurts and there's literally no one here to see me crying, so I might as well just let it all out. It's mostly shock and like that after effect of when you have a big fall or a big scare like that, and then, you know, your emotions catch up with the rest of you and you're like, holy crap, that was bad. I could have just snapped my arm. So I cried a little bit, then I was fine. But it hurt all day and it's hurting today. And yeah, it's a little bit slow going at the moment. And so while my whole entire left side, because I landed on my hip real bad too, so like my arm and my hip took a real bad beating, and so pretty much my entire left side is pretty rough except for my ankle is fine, thank goodness. So I'm gonna have to take it a little bit easy while I recuperate, but I am gonna keep slowly working on dyeing some stuff. We'll continue doing yarn clubs, and hopefully in August I can have some more great fun yarns coming to the shop for you. So keep an eye out for the BFL, but there's some in there already if you want to go check it out and give it a try knitting with it. I hope that was really educational and informative for you. I hope it was fun. I really hope it inspires you to go try something new, whether that's Blue Faced Leicester or just looking for other wool breeds or other non-wool fibers like cotton and bamboo and things. The whole point of this series is to help us feel more educated and more adventurous so that we're actually intentionally choosing fibers and stretching ourselves beyond our comfort zone. I think for most of us, merino and acrylic tend to be our comfort zones, right? Especially if you're a fairly new beginner, a lot of times we start new beginners on acrylics because they're cheap, they're easy to work with, we don't have to worry about wool allergies, etc. And then even if you started with wool, a lot of us stay in that merino range for quite a long time. And so let's try to get out of our comfort zone and try some new things. But I hope that helps you, and I hope you have a great rest of your week. Love you.